Good morning. Is this thing on? There we go. Well, if the first service was a well-rested group, you guys gotta be. I mean, second service, an extra hour of sleep. So let's stand together. And I'm going to read from one of my favorite psalms, Psalm 37. And I'm certain I have opened our worship service with some of these passages before, but they are worth repeating. Psalm 37, 3 says, "Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday." So trust in the Lord, delight in the Lord, and commit your way to the Lord. Let's do that today. Amen. Let's worship him.
This is how we know. This is how we know what love is. Just one look at your cross. This is where we see. This is where we see how love works. For you surrendered your all. This is how we know that you have loved us first. This is where we chose to love you in return. For you so loved the world that you gave your only son. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in return. For this life that you give, for this death that you have died. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in reply, Lord. This is how we know. This is how we know what love is. Just one look at your cross. And this is where we see. This is where we see how love works. For you surrendered your all. And this is how we know that you have loved us first. This is where we chose to love you in return. For you so loved the world that you gave your only son. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in return. For this life that you give, for this death that you have died. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in reply. For you so loved the world that you gave your only son. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in return. For this life that you give, for this death that you have died. Love amazing, so divine. We will love you in reply, Lord. King Jesus, we love you, for we have been loved. King Jesus, we love you, for we have been loved. King Jesus, we love you, for we have been loved. King Jesus, we love you, for we have been loved. We have been loved.
Amen. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, your love for us is truly amazing. Thank you so much for it, Lord, and for the sacrifice that you have made so that we can have relationship with you. Lord, we lift up this time to you. We pray that you would be high and lifted up And Lord, that our hearts would be humbled before you and that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. Jesus, bless this time now as we worship you, as we study your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's take a moment and say hello to one another. Well, good morning again. So for those of you that were in Israel, welcome home. You were missed. Carol and Susie and John and Corey, I see you. And I feel like, remember Romper Room? I see so-and-so, and I see Jim, and I see Pastor Rob. Welcome home. You guys were definitely missed, and I hope you're back on California time. We have several announcements for you today. This past year, a group of us in this body have been hand copying different books of the Bible, and we've gone through several of them. I haven't counted yet, but probably 12, 13 so far. Anyway, this month we are continuing that, and we're copying the book of Hebrews. And so you are welcome to join us in that. What are we, 5 days into it? So we're doing 10 verses a day, so you got about 50 verses to catch up. If you want to start today, welcome you to do that. Just great exercise to help us get God's word into us, so encourage you to do that. Tonight, we are going to be watching a film on the Protestant Reformation, and the director, or the filmmaker, will actually be here tonight to introduce his film to us and take questions and answers afterwards. So we invite you to come out for that. We're very excited about that, and Pastor Rob will talk more on that. Also, ladies, Bible study continues this Thursday morning and evening. Chapters 9 and 10 will be covered this week, so be prepared for that, and you can see Tamara if you have any questions and more details on that Bible study. High school and college kids, we'll be having a bonfire this week for you. It's called the Fall Flan Festival. I'm not sure if I said that right. Fall Flanstival. There you go. So we'll be having dinner and s'mores and ping pong. That'll be this Saturday, November 11th, at Eli and Jessica Maxwell's home. And the cost is just $5 for all of that. So you can sign up today. The deadline to sign up will be this Wednesday, the 8th. And last announcement, we're saving the best for last. Men's. We're having our men's shoot again, our skeet shoot and lunch coming up in a couple weeks on Saturday, November 18th. So all Calvary Chapel men and boys can join us for that. We'll be having a shoot and a lunch that day. So for just $15 a person, we're going to provide the shotgun shells for 12-gauge shotguns, clay pigeons, and a Togo's lunch. So sign up at the table in the back after service, and love to have all you guys come out to that. We always have a good time, have a lot of laughs, and no injuries. So that's it. For additional details and other ministries and things going on at Calvary Chapel Turlock, check ccturlock.com or your bulletin. And let's stand together and we'll continue to worship the Lord.
Now it's off again, TJ. No. Okay, we'll fake it. Nobody's gonna know TJ, it'll be okay. When I
survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. My richest gain I count but loss, and poor contempt on all my pride. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow. Such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die, and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Word whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
Wonderful cross,
oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross.
by grace draw near and bless your name. Lord, we thank you that those words are true, that we did not have to come of our own effort, Lord, of our own merit. And indeed, you've told us that we cannot come to you by something that we can do. We can only come because of what you have provided. But Lord, you have been faithful to give us that way in your mercy and in your grace, that you have made a way and drawn us to you. Thank you, Lord, for forgiveness. Thank you for the love that you have poured out on us. We pray, Lord, that we would be a people that honor you completely. For you, Lord, are worthy of our praise. Bless your holy name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated as we continue in worship.
I see the stars,
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Let's stand as we sing. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you for providing that for us. And Lord, out of a thankful and grateful heart, may you receive these tithes and offerings that you've purposed on each man and woman's heart to give to you. And Lord, may you use them and may you bless them and may you multiply them for the furtherance of your kingdom, for the spreading of your gospel throughout this world. We pray this in your precious and holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you ever want to know what it sounds like to unplug a guitar when you're not supposed to, that's what it sounds like. Christmas miracle? All right.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy. Worthy, oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Well, thank you, worship team. Thank you, Jason. Good morning to everyone. It's great to see you this morning out to worship the Lord. I'm glad to be back. I've been a couple weeks in Israel, and so nice to see you again, as it always is. And I think of Jason. Is it nice to be back and leading the congregation in a normal way?
I thought so.
He thought so. It's funny. I say that because when we were in Israel, Jason led our worship, and we had to find all these different places to worship, and he had to be very, very flexible. And one time, we literally set up our worship. The place that we could find was right in the middle of this path as people were going up to the springs of En Gedi. And there's Jason singing and leading us, and these tourists are coming by, and they're all taking pictures of us and filming us worship. So Jason's going to wind up on the internet somewhere anyway. But that was it was a great trip, and we'll be talking about that in just a moment. Thank you, Jason. Tonight, I also wanted to thank Dan for holding the fort down while I was gone. Yes, thank Pastor Dan. And tonight we have a Reformation film. This is 500 years of the Reformation. We're going to show that tonight. Dr. Richard Weikart, he is a professor at Stan State. He attends Calvary Chapel Merced, and we won't hold that against him. And he made a documentary personally, went to Europe and filmed the sites, and so he is going to be presenting that tonight and open it up for questions. So love to have as many people come out, even bring the kids, and they might enjoy the movie, and he'll answer a few questions. And so celebrating 500 years of the Reformation tonight with a documentary, and the maker of the film will be here on site to answer questions. Okay? Is Joseph Montanez here? Joseph, come on up here, young man. Yes, sir, he says. All right. You can tell he just got out of boot camp, right? Come on up, Joseph. All right. Great to have you here and have you back. How long have you been in the Navy now?
About 10 months now.
10 months. Okay, and where are you serving? Where are you stationed?
I'm going to be stationed over at Dam Neck, Virginia for
okay.
the next few months for
okay.
my last bit of my training.
And then, and where off to? Then where, do you know yet?
I have no idea.
Don't know where your orders are. Okay.
Ship.
Okay, so Joseph left us about 10 months ago, joined the Navy, and I just always have a soft spot in my heart for guys that go off to serve. So we're very very proud of you serving our nation, defending our freedom. And I just want to lift you to the Lord, okay? Can we do that?
Yeah.
All right, Joseph. Well, Lord, we just thank you for Joseph. I thank you for his life. I pray that you would bless him and protect him in his service, first and foremost to you, Lord, as he serves you. And Lord, you know more than perhaps any place how much temptation is thrown at a young man in the service, but I pray that you would keep him strong and that he would keep his eyes and his life focused on you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for his life and his service given to his country to really keep us free as a free people, Lord. And we need men and women that take that very seriously and go out and serve, and Joseph has done that. It's a picture of you, Lord, as Jesus, you came to serve so that we might have life. And I just ask your blessing upon Joseph, Lord, and we thank you for his life, and protect him in all the places that he goes, Lord, and watch over him, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Joseph, for your service. You're welcome. Very good. Also, why, Emma, are you having a birthday?
Next week.
Okay, well, that's pretty good. So wish Wyama happy birthday this week. All right, very good. Excellent. And Bob Monroe, are you having a birthday this week?
Sooner than
he can imagine. Go ahead and call it up here. All right, happy 80th birthday. How old were you there? 10 years old, 10 or 11? Yeah. 27 there, right? Or 20, how old were you married, Mom?
26.
All right, there's Mom and Dad. And then that's me and my brother right there, and then his grandma. And how old were you about there? There's probably 32 or so?
37.
Yeah, 37. And then the hair got white. What happened? I remember your 40th birthday like it was only 40 years ago. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Bob. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dad. 80 years. Wow. It goes quick, doesn't it?
Very fast.
And we'll be having cake afterwards for your birthday. So everybody, afterwards, get a piece of cake in honor of Bob Monroe's 80th. That's kind of a big one, 80. All right. Now, Israel pictures. We will get to the service eventually, I promise you. Okay, Several of you asked, hey, I'd like to see some pictures of what you guys did. Jason took these on his phone. So that's not a pitch for the iPhone, but Jason might pitch it that way. This is Capernaum. This is where the Sea of Galilee. We're in the north from Capernaum, looking south over the Sea of Galilee. And this is where Jesus did much of his ministry, right there in Capernaum. He made the northern headquarters of Capernaum his sort of his center of his ministry when he was ministering up in the north. And so we got to go around there and got to go to the synagogue that was there in Jesus' time. And so we saw a lot of Capernaum. And also, you know that Bethsaida and Chorazin were also two cities in that area as well. So that's on the northern side of the Dead Sea. Let's go to the next one. Okay, this is the northern city of Dan. And I'm actually going to make reference to this in the sermon today. They've uncovered a temple there, a false temple, false worship. Now, that steel that you see, that's just been erected there, so you might see what the false altar looked like. But this is all original that they've uncovered, and from the city of Dan, where false worship was established, and they worshiped the golden calf. We're actually talking a little bit about that this morning. So that's all been excavated. Next. This is Nazareth. We were there. The city down there is not Nazareth. Nazareth would be behind us, but this is the high place where, when Jesus was rejected at Nazareth, they went to push him off the cliff, off the high place. They think that might be it right there. Beautiful view of the Jezreel Valley there, looking south once again. Go ahead. This is Qumran. This is where one of the shepherd boys found, I think 100 years ago or so, found some clay pots, and inside were scrolls. And these scrolls had all the books of the Old Testament, except Esther, I believe, and almost perfectly preserved book of Isaiah. And the book of Isaiah that we have, it was from 2,000 years ago, about Jesus' time, and the book of Isaiah that we have today matches with the book of Isaiah, of those scrolls. So just a tremendous demonstration of the reliability of Scripture. Okay, next. We were there. This group of holy people got baptized in the Jordan River. That is actually the Jordan River. You got to rent these little white garments, and then you go in, and several people wanted to get baptized, and we actually did that there in the Jordan River, and funny little minnows nibble at your feet while you're doing it. So that was a weird sensation, but interesting. Okay. It's a military memorial there up on the Golan Heights. If you look to, this is Dad here, this is Craig, off here about 300 yards or so was the border, was Syria. We were on the Golan Heights, literally looking right out over Syria. And we were doing a Bible study on the conversion of Paul on the road to Damascus, right on that road going out to Damascus about 25 or 30 miles off, and just speaking about how Paul was converted and met Jesus there. And while we're talking about this, while I'm actually doing the Bible study, we hear pop, 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 pop. I thought, all right, war's breaking out right here. Pass out the M16s and the helmets, we're going. No, actually, it was just some fighting that was going on in Syria, and that's what Israel has to deal with all of the time. And so we heard it going on, even a couple of explosions. And so they were going to man the tanks right there. Okay, next. And this is now from the Mount of Olives, looking at up at Jerusalem. That's the Eastern Gate. And the Messiah, Jesus, will come through the Eastern Gate in his second coming. You want to know what the Eastern Gate is? There it is. That's been blocked up. Now, we don't know this for sure, but it seems to make sense. When Islam took over the Holy Land, one of the sultans heard that the Messiah would come through the Eastern Gate, and so he blocked it all up, put stones in it, and then put an Islamic cemetery right there, so that no Jewish priest would ever come through that. They don't know that's not going to stop Jesus. He's coming, all right? Okay, next slide. This is up on the Temple Mount itself. First time that I had gotten to go up there. The Dome of the Rock Mosque is there, but that temple will probably be rebuilt on the northern side here. This is south looking north. Behind us would be the Al-Aqsa Mosque, but that's that Dome of the Rock Mosque that you often see. And all of these things from hundreds, 1,500 years ago. Incredible history there. This is the temple lampstand. They're already accumulating items. There's something called the Temple Institute. They're already accumulating items to go in the temple. We got to go through a tour of that. They're already stacking things up. They are ready to build that temple. This is the Garden Tomb, very special place. They were very good to tell you, we don't know if this is the place, but boy, the description is very good. There's the place of the skull right next to it, and you go down into this garden, and this was a rich man's tomb. It all fits very well with the biblical narrative that where Jesus was laid, and then 3 days later came out alive. And there's our group. You can see that's the Dome of the Rock Mosque right there, overlooking from the Mount of Olives, overlooking Jerusalem right there. This is our guide, Naftali, and our group, all with big smiles on, having a great time. We walked all over that place, but we survived. Okay? And then where's Carol in this thing? Look, here's Carol right here. Carol, 85 years old, walked the whole thing with us. It was incredible. Even through Hezekiah's tunnel, this little tiny narrow tunnel where you have to bend down through that Hezekiah carved to bring water into the city. Carol did it. She did it all, didn't she? Huh? Very good. All right. Very good. Let's stand together. Yes. And open in our Bibles to Revelation chapter 13. Revelation chapter 13. And if you need a Bible, please raise your hand and our ushers will get one to you. If you are visiting with us this morning, we're studying through the book of Revelation, and we find ourselves in chapter 13, verse 1. And I've entitled this message, The Antichrist, Part 2. So let's read, as John writes, and he says this, "Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as if it were mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast. And they worship the beast, saying, Who is like the beast? Why? Who is able to make war with him? And he was given a mouth, speaking great things and blasphemies. And he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints." Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, you call us to yourselves to be like you, to belong to you, to be sanctified, to be set apart from this world. And we know that can only come by the power of your Holy Spirit working in our lives through your word. We have to know your word and apply this word to our lives. And Lord, we pray that you would have that effect upon us this morning. We love you. We are so grateful for the salvation that we have. Lord, I pray that we as a congregation would walk in love, that we would walk in light, that we would walk in your wisdom, and that you would accomplish that as we just open the pages of Scripture and receive what you have for us this morning. We ask your blessing upon this time. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, last time we were together, we spoke about the world's current conditions, both political and spiritual, as they are becoming ripe for the Antichrist. As we've said, the world today is moving towards something called globalization, as it is looking for strong world leadership to solve the problems of the planet. Even as the Paris Treaty for Global Climate Change serves as a ready example of this, environmental and social problems are increasingly taking on a global aspect. And so they have these treaties, these get-togethers, and they want the nations of the world to come and decide what the solution will be for the entire world to follow. And when one or two of these nations don't go along, the rest of the nations get frustrated. They want there to be some authority, some sort of force that they can exert against the nations so that they all have to comply. And so all of this is paving the way for a strong and charismatic and powerful world leader who will come on the scene and he will implement global solutions. And that's exactly what we're seeing here in Revelation 13. We're seeing the description of the Antichrist, the description of the beast, as he is called, that will come on the world scene. He will take that leadership and all will pledge allegiance to him. And so we read in verse 2 there. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. Now notice there, we see that John uses the word like. He does that to show us that this is a simile. He doesn't say the beast is a leopard. He said the beast is like a leopard. He's like a ferocious animal. Now John is using a simile to make a comparison, a metaphor, or we might even say symbology here. And I think one of the great helpful tools in understanding symbology in the Bible is to receive it the way that the reader would have 1900 years ago in the early church when John wrote to them. Remember, John wrote the book of Revelation as a letter. It was sent out to seven churches. They would open it up in their synagogues, which was where the church started, in their synagogues. And they would, you know, they were formed a church at this time. And they would read that scroll just like we're reading the Word of God today, doing the same thing 1900 years later. Now, how would they have taken that? How would they have received what John wrote? I think in taking that approach, it helps us to understand a lot of the symbology and what he's trying to say to the people. Because remember, the early church had a lot of working people in it. Now, some of them were highly trained. Some of them, no doubt, knew the scriptures from Judaism. But some of them were just slaves that had come to Christ. And they did not really have any formal education whatsoever. So many Bible scholars today believe that this list of animals here in verse 2 that he points out represent different nations or empires, which may be true. There may be evidence for that. But I think an early reader in the early church would have read the words, he is going to be like a leopard, and they would have thought of speed, agility, and strength. I mean, they knew what a leopard was. A leopard has the ability to pounce on prey, to kill it, to drag it up into a tree and eat it. They would have said, oh, he's going to be like that. He's going to be very powerful. He's going to go after people who come against him and kill them. They would have read that he's going to have feet like the feet of a bear, and they would have thought of stability, something very hard to move. I mean, you can't go up and push a bear over, can you? The feet of a bear are stable. They are secure. And so this would have meant in their minds the ruling, the power, the kingdom of this leader won't be easily moved. And then they would have read he had a mouth like a lion. And they would have seen that as something fierce, as deadly, foreboding. I mean, the teeth and the mouth of the lion, that kills. That has great power. So John is telling us that the beast, the Antichrist that is coming upon the scene, is going to be like a wild animal in his cunning, his power, and ferocity. And that's how the church would have understood this description. He will use his ability to overtake the whole world, and no one will be able to stand against him. And anyone that does will be like a prey in the mouth of a lion. And then we see in verse 3 that John sees in this vision one of the heads of the seven heads as though it is mortally wounded, but then was healed. We read there in verse 3, and I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world marveled and followed the beast. Now, there's a lot of disagreement among contemporary scholars as to the meaning of this verse. Some see this as the death and the revival of an empire, of a kingdom. We've talked about that the seven heads probably represent seven kingdoms, seven empires. And so the death of this one head and then the rising up of this one head could be like the resurrection of the old Roman Empire. Some have said that. Europe today is the remnant, the leftover of the Roman Empire. Some have thought, well, this must be speaking about, you know, the Roman Empire is kind of disintegrated, it's all broken apart, but if they were to come back together and speak Latin again and take on the names of Rome, then that would be a resurrection, and that might overwhelm people and awe them. Other commentators believe that this is very personal, Other commentators believe that we're dealing with an individual here, a type of death, a mortal wound, and then a resurrection of an individual, of a world leader. Chapter 13 of this book, verse 13, speaking of the false prophet that accompanies the Antichrist, John does make it rather personal, and he says, "And he exercises all authority of the first beast in his presence, and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed." And so he makes it personal there. And many commentators have said this is talking about an individual person. So it would appear that John is describing a wound and a type of resurrection that is going to be experienced by the Antichrist. Maybe an assassination attempt on his life. But we know as Christians, obviously, that only the Lord has the power to take the dead and raise them again to life. So it would appear that this is probably a counterfeit, an attempt on his life, some sort of wound that looks like it's deadly, looks like he's suffered a mortal wound, and then he recovers, and people will say, this was a resurrection. He is risen from the dead, and they will give and pledge their allegiance to him as they are just overwhelmed spiritually by it. But he's a counterfeit. He is actually Antichrist. And just as Jesus really died and really rose again, so this will be a counterfeit. It will appear that he died, and it will appear that he rose again. And we have these tremendous parallels from history to show us how this kind of thing might actually happen. We don't have to go too far back in history to see this, do we? If you know the history of World War II, there's a fascinating story that took place during that time. When a German colonel by the name of Klaus von Stauffenberg conspired with numerous German generals and leaders to actually kill Hitler. They knew that Hitler had gone off the rails. They knew that he was now a madman. They could see what he was doing to their own country and to Europe. They had been deceived before, and now many eyes were open. They said, we got to kill this guy. He's going to destroy us all. I mean, he will take us into absolute destruction of the whole society. And so in July of 1944, just a year left in the war, they plotted to kill him. And Klaus von Stauffenberg, this colonel, had access to Hitler. He was one of the leaders of the conspiracy. He had suffered some major wounds in North Africa. He had actually lost a hand in one of his eyes. And he was carrying a briefcase with a bomb in it to get close to Hitler. And he went in there to the Wolf's Lair, that field headquarters in Prussia. It's a great story if you ever get time to read it or study it. And he went into where Hitler was, but he had to arm the bomb. And he was kind of limited because he just had one hand. So he made an excuse to go out of the room. He armed one bomb, but he didn't get the other explosive armed because he was interrupted. He went back into the room. He placed the briefcase right by Hitler. It was moved because it was in the way behind this very solid and sturdy leg of the table. And when the bomb went off, Hitler survived. He was protected from the bomb. And what did he do? Hitler immediately stood up and claimed that he was protected by God and that he was ruling with divine blessing and assurance. And then he used that to consolidate his power. And he had all the conspirators rounded up and killed, almost 5,000 rounded up, arrested, tortured, and killed because of that attempt on his life. So you see, there's nothing new under the sun. What we've even seen in history, the Bible is describing what is going to happen in the future. This Antichrist will rise in power. Someone will try to kill him. It will have an effect upon him, and it will appear as though he died and rose again. It will be a false resurrection, but the world will be absolutely awed by it all. This wound, this assassination attempt, and then his recovery will cause the world to revere him. In verse 4, we read, "So they worshiped the dragon, who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, 'Who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him?'" Now notice this very critical fact here. And this is always, always true. A very critical fact that is always true. When the world worships the beast, a man, the Antichrist, they are actually worshiping the dragon. And we've already established the symbology, the dragon is Satan. To worship anyone else besides God, to worship a man or anything else, is to worship Satan. And that's what's going on here at this time. The Antichrist is going to be more than just a political leader that comes on the scene. He's going to be more than just a politician that stands up and gives very powerful speeches and offers solutions for the healing of the world. He will actually demand to be worshipped as God. Just like the Caesars of old. Once again, we can just go to history. We have the examples. This is nothing new. The Caesars, they were the emperors of the Roman Empire. But they weren't just satisfied with being emperors and having political power. They wanted to be worshipped. And that's, of course, why Christians were killed during that reign, during those reigns of the Caesars. Because Christians were very glad to say, Caesar, I will obey you. Caesar, I will pay taxes. Caesar, I will do everything that you ask of me that's not against the word of God. But I will not, I cannot worship you. And they demanded it, and so Christians were persecuted and killed. And the same thing is going to happen again, the Bible tells us. But what we see here is that when they worship the Antichrist, the beast, they are actually worshiping the demonic realm, Satan himself. Remember, in the Old Testament, there was a king in Israel by the name of Jeroboam. And he did not want his people going down to Jerusalem to worship. He thought he would lose his power. So he set up a false worship system, a false temple with false priests and a false altar up in the northern city of Dan, the very, very northern portion of Israel. And he told the people, come here to worship. You don't need to go to Jerusalem and bring your sacrifices there. You can come to this place and offer your gifts to the Lord. And he set up a golden calf there. And they came in and they worshiped. And I would imagine that if you had asked every single Israelite that had come there to worship, they would have said, oh no, we're not worshiping a false god. We're not partaking in idolatry. We're just coming to worship the Lord in this different way with this golden calf. And the Bible tells us in 2 Chronicles 11:15, then he, that is Jeroboam, appointed for himself priests for the high places, for the demons and the calf idol which he had made. And so it was demonic. The Bible says when you go to worship anything other than the Lord, demons are involved. It's the demonic realm. And that's exactly why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10:19 through 20, speaking to the Corinthians, in the New Testament, he said, what am I saying then? That an idol is anything, or what is offered to idols is anything? Rather, that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. The Apostle Paul was saying in the New Testament to the church, look, all around you, you are surrounded by idolatry. They take wood, they take pottery, they take clay, they take gold and silver, and they make these idols, and people bow down to them. But there's no power in the thing. I mean, the wood, the gold, the silver, the pottery, that has no power. It's not that the idol itself is anything substantial, but it's what surrounds it. It's what's behind it. That's all idolatry that has a demonic force and a demonic power involved. Because Satan's desire is to get your worship off of the Lord and away from the Lord and onto something else. And that's what makes it demonic. You see, the Bible is very clear. The worship of idols, the worship of nature, money, man, the worship of anything besides the Lord is idolatry, but it is also demonic. The devil is behind that. Remember, we said that there are two great errors when it comes to the demonic realm. First of all, it is to pay too much attention to Satan and to have this unhealthy fascination or curiosity in the things surrounding the demonic. You just go overboard, always talking about Satan. That's not healthy. That's not good. But the other one is like it, and that's to disbelieve completely in Satan or his power and to say that there is no demonic realm. That's very dangerous as well. So eventually the world is going to bow down and worship this world leader. They will pledge their allegiance to him, and though they don't realize it, though the world is probably not acknowledging it, they are actually worshiping Satan in doing this. To worship anyone or anything other than God himself is demonic. Why? Because Satan is the great deceiver, and his whole mission is to deceive people away from worshiping the true and living God. So if you turn to anything or everything else besides God, Satan is satisfied because he's gotten your eye, your mind, your heart, your soul focused away from the Lord and onto another thing. And he's very pleased in doing that. You don't have to worship Satan himself. You can worship a thing. And Satan says, I'm satisfied with that. I've achieved my goal. And that's why the Antichrist will be marked by such pride and blasphemy as he exalts himself against the God of heaven. He will be motivated by the devil to do that. And so we read there in verses 5 and 6, and he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. Blasphemy comes out of his mouth because he's inspired, he is working, he is given the power from Satan himself. You see, the Antichrist that is eventually coming on the scene, and his whole government will be marked by this exaltation of self over and against God. That will be his identifying mark. He's going to exalt himself over and against God. Now, you may look at that and you say, well, that's been true of most dictators, right? Most dictators in the history of the world, they've exalted themselves over and against God in everything that they do. And that's the reason that Christians are so consistently persecuted through the history of the world. When you just look at a timeline of the world, of the New Testament age, Christians have been persecuted, even killed for their faith, because governments have this tendency, despots, they rise up and they want to exert final and ultimate control over everyone, and they want people to worship them, and Christians say no, they get in the way. That's the reason that Christians have been so consistently persecuted, because as a Christian, we worship the true and living God, and we live according to the will and the word of God, and so we get in the way of the state's quest for unlimited power, for the exaltation of man. The state doesn't like it, and so they kill Christians. If you've taken a government class, and I mean a good government class ever, you know why our forefathers penned a very strict constitution. It was to limit government. It was to put a stopgap between government and liberty. The Constitution enumerates and it limits the power of government so that we as a people can enjoy liberty and freedom. It even gives us in the Bill of Rights the freedom of religion, which we have this morning. You come in here, no secret police. We're outside watching and taking down your license plate number. And that happens in many parts of the world. So we still have freedom to congregate, to assemble, to worship the Lord. And even then, we're seeing that protection steadily erode in daily life, aren't we? As judges are making more and more decisions against that freedom and against that liberty. The idea today is, well, you can practice your religion as long as it's in these four walls. That's fine, but don't take it outside. Don't try to pray after a football game. Don't bring your Bible to school or something like that, completely off limits. So we're seeing these things erode. But governments always have this tendency to expand and expand and to exalt themselves as gods on earth. And the Antichrist will follow that pattern exactly with himself and his government. And he will be successful. He will achieve for a limited time that unimpeded authority over the world as he will become the ultimate autocrat, the ultimate dictator of the world. And he will use that power to exalt himself over God, over the people of God, and the things of God. And he will succeed where other earthly governments have failed. But it will only be, as we know, for a very limited time. Jesus tells us in Matthew 10:16, "Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Therefore, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves." Be as wise as serpents and as harmless as doves. You know, my heart as a pastor for this church, for this congregation, is that you would know and understand the world and the culture that you live in. That's why I try to bring in examples of what's happening in the world, current events, things that are going on from history to this day, where we can project forward things that are happening in the government, because I want you to know and to understand the world and the culture in which we live. There's an old saying, I think it's an old Chinese saying, I'm not sure. I know that's kind of something that someone says, an old Chinese saying, maybe it is. But the saying is this: If you want to understand the nature of water, do not ask a fish. That presupposes your fish could talk. You can go to your little fish tank and speak to your fish. Might be a little goofy there. But if your fish could talk and you wanted to know about the nature of water, don't ask a fish. Why? Because a fish cannot give you a counter perspective. Water is all the fish knows. That's where he lives. That's where he thrives. That's the only thing he understands. And so he cannot give you any comparison. Water is like this or water is like that because it's all he knows. He has nothing to compare it to. I want us as a congregation, I want us as a church to be wise, to understand and to know the world that we live in. I want us to be able to compare the culture and to make comparisons, and we can only do that outside of the culture with the Word of God. This is the only place that you're going to get a counter perspective to what's happening in the world today. We've got to be wise, just as Jesus told us. We live in a world today. We live in a world where the systems of this world, government, education, entertainment, media, science, finance, sports, recreation, are all colluding together to capture your worship and to take you away from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you're new here, or maybe you're someone that's even been here a long time, you're thinking, come on, Rob, that's a little paranoid, isn't it? It's a little over-suspicious. You're saying that all the systems of the world are colluding together to destroy our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Yes, I am. That's exactly what I'm saying. That's exactly the world that we live in today. You see, Satan is real. And Satan can pose as an angel of light. He can pose as something noble, as something virtuous, as something good, even as something great. But his entire goal is to steal your heart and your affection and to deceive you from seeing and practicing the truth and worshiping the Lord in the truth, in spirit and in truth. And he'll use any and every system to accomplish that task. Literally, any and every system that can hook you and take you away from the truth, no matter how good it appears, no matter how noble it seems, he'll use that thing. And that's why the Bible gives us such stark warnings about idolatry. Things that would stand in the way of your service to the Lord. There are idols everywhere, all around us. Now, most Americans, most people in Western culture, we're a little too sophisticated to actually put up an idol and pray to that thing, aren't we? It does happen in countries. If you go to the Far East, that still happens. Literally, they set out little idols, they'll light incense to it, and they'll bring food, offerings of food to that thing. But we don't see that in America, we don't see that in Europe, not in a Western context. But that doesn't mean that there's no idolatry. It just means that it's taking on different forms. It means that it's morphed now into modern complex systems. And these are the things that now take our affections and our love and our attention away from the Lord. And it is idolatry. Let me illustrate it this way. Anything and everything that steals your heart away from the Lord is an idol. Anything and everything that steals your heart away from the Lord is an idol. So let's take the subject of sports. I'm about to clear out the church here, aren't I? We're not going to have a church next week, are we? Take the subject of sports. Now, bear in mind, I was a varsity college athlete, so I'm not against sports in and of themselves. I played in high school. I played water polo. I swam. I wrestled for 2 years. I went on to play varsity water polo at the Naval Academy for 4 years. So I understand sports. I understand athletics. I understand there are great things that come out of sports. Hard work, discipline. You get out what you put in. Teamwork. I mean, I get it. So I'm not against sports in and of themselves. All of my kids played sports in one form or another. So I'm not against sports in the general sense. I'm just using it as an example of one system in our culture today. And I've noticed that in sports, in American contemporary sports, they demand incredible time of the family today. And I've seen that you get involved and it's something good, and pretty soon the coach says, well, now we need to start doing double workouts, and of course we're going to have you for the weekend. We need Saturday and Sunday because you got this big tournament coming on, this championship is coming up, and we need the weekends. And pretty soon families get involved in that, and they disappear from the body of Christ. And you see someone, you say, hey, where you been? Well, we're really involved in this thing, and we're doing it for the kids. And yeah, but where's your commitment to the body of Christ? Where's your commitment to the Lord? Well, you know, that'll be there later, but right now we've got to do this sports thing. And once again, you can substitute any other system in there. I'm just using this as one example. And it consumes the time and the energy and the focus of the family. And they get taken off the rails somewhere else. And before you know it, the family is missing half of the Sundays, three quarters of the Sundays. And you just say, are you ever going to spend time in the body of Christ? Are you ever going to worship and serve the Lord? We'll get to it later. Now, please hear me. Once again, I reiterate that sports in and of themselves are not wrong. I'm not saying that. I'm just using this as one example. But every worldly system, no matter what it is, whether it is government or education or entertainment or media or science or finance or recreation or sports, no matter what it is, if it takes you away from the Lord, it is idolatry. It is the spirit of the Antichrist. You know, the Antichrist will use someday, when he comes on the scene, his power and authority and his followers, his entire system, to demand worship. Worship of himself away from the Lord. But what we see today, what we see happening all around us, is that the spirit of the Antichrist is already here. Not the Antichrist himself. Will there be a literal Antichrist that comes on the scene and demands to be worshipped? Absolutely. But the spirit of the Antichrist is already in existence as people are turning their hearts and their minds over to other things and not the Lord himself. Now, please believe me, as a pastor, I'm telling you this from the experience that I've had. I've seen it in too many lives already. I've seen too many people turn their time and their energies over to something else, even something that might be really good, but it takes them away from the Lord. It is just too common, and they disappear from the body of Christ. And that thing becomes an idol. It becomes the spirit of the Antichrist. And ultimately, Paul told the Corinthians that anything that takes your loyalty and your devotion away from the Lord, that thing is demonic. Satan's whole goal is to get you to worship something else. That's the spirit of idolatry. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. I was convicted this past week when I was in Israel as we walked through the Rabbi's Tunnel. The Rabbi's Tunnel is a tunnel that goes along the western wall there. And they've actually excavated below the city of Jerusalem. The city of Jerusalem is about, 70, 80 feet above that. And that was all built upon one layer upon another since the time of Jesus. But now they've excavated along the western wall below the modern city. And you can actually see the streets and the times of Jesus down there. And they're uncovering all these artifacts and coins and examples of what life was like during the time of Jesus. And as you go through this tunnel, and some of it's very narrow, and you're kind of walking along this tunnel, there were Orthodox Jews that had come into that tunnel to pray against that western wall. And as you're literally going by them shoulder to shoulder, kind of maneuvering through that tunnel, they are there pressed up against the wall with their prayer book, practicing their religion. And you know how they pray. They pray with their whole body, and so they'll often rock like this when they pray. And they're pressed up in that tunnel, and we're kind of moving around them. We're not wanting to interfere with them. And I saw them in there, and this is the middle of the day, and I was thinking, boy, they were really setting aside a lot of time to leave their lives. They were moms and dads, and, you know, they had regular lives as well there in Jerusalem, and they had come into that tunnel there to come against that wall and to pray in the middle of the day and pray very fervently. And I thought to myself, I was convicted, do we as evangelical Christians, are we willing to serve the Lord in that way? Are we willing to set aside time in our busy schedules and our busy weeks to serve the Lord? Now, obviously, we don't have to go to a wall. We don't have to go to a place. I'm not saying that. We can pray anywhere. We don't even have to come into church to pray. But my point is this. We've got so many things happening in our lives. Would we be willing to set that aside to come and seek the Lord? Or would we say, like we so often do, I'm just too busy. I got too many things going on. Those things get in the way. And when they get in the way of our service to the Lord, they become idols, don't they? It becomes idolatry. I was convicted by what I was seeing. This Antichrist is coming to dominate the world. But his spirit, the spirit of Satan, is already working in the world. And he wants to accomplish the same goal, and that is to cause people to worship something other than the Lord Jesus Christ. That's his whole desire. Satan's desire is to steer us off the path. So let's be careful as Christians. Let's be very suspicious of anything that comes into our lives, any system, even if it appears good, that would steal your worship and your devotion from the Lord Jesus. Because when it does, that thing is the spirit of the Antichrist, that thing is idolatry. But we as a church, we worship the true and living God, and we can't allow anything to get in the way of our pursuit of the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, the men would come forward. And if you would turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, if you would like. Paul writes to the Corinthians, and he says in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23, he says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup." And so the Apostle Paul was telling the Corinthians what was passed to him by the Lord Jesus Christ, that we are to do something called the Lord's Supper. Now, normally we do this on Sunday night, but every once in a while we're going to have this on Sunday morning. And we have what you call an open table, an open communion, meaning that if you belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've trusted in him for salvation, you are free to partake, okay? You don't have to be a particular member of this church, not that we have formal membership, but just that you belong to the Lord, that you trust in him. You're free to partake of the elements. And the Lord said to his disciples, "Do this in remembrance of me." And so that's what we're doing. We're being faithful to the command of Jesus. You know, when you think about the crucifixion, you think about how bloody it was, how penalizing it was, how degrading it was to Jesus, there could be that tendency to say, well, we ought to forget those things and kind of push it aside. And Jesus says, no, no, do it in remembrance of me. Remember the price that I paid for you. Remember the price of your salvation, because it cost me everything. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we ask for your blessing upon this time, as we do remember, Jesus, the price that you paid for our sins. And now we just consecrate this time, Lord, to concentrate upon you and to remember and to really be touched in our hearts, our souls, Lord, by the great cost of our salvation, and that you held nothing back so that we might be saved. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for this ordinance you've given the church, and that it might impact our hearts deeply as we truly commune with you. In Jesus' name, amen.